Today's episode is being sponsored in full by Heartlift International, a 501c3 completely and totally dedicated to making home and family the safest, most secure place on earth. If you'd like to know more about Heartlift International and would like to donate to support this podcast, just hop over to heartliftcentral.com/heartlift-international. Today's show is part two of my riveting conversation with Chris Rice, director of the United Nations Office of the Mennonite Central Committee, an international relief, development, and peace agency. He was also the co-founding director of the Duke Divinity School Center for Reconciliation. Chris has worked to heal social conflicts in East Africa, Northeast Asia, and the American South. What I love most about my conversation in part one with Chris is how he was so authentic and vulnerable in stating that it was easier for him to actually go to North Korea in working with mediation and conflict than it was for him to cross the border into North Carolina, where he had to address some family issues and some very personal issues in his life. That has stayed with me, and I have shared that with so many people because, you know, Heartlifters, that is the work you and me are committed to do in our daily lives. We want to become so healthy, healthy sense of self, healthy behavior patterns, and even healthier communication skills, so that we can go into our spheres of influence, our families being first, our marriages, our relationships, our church commitments, and stand in the center of those spheres as healthy people of God. That's what we do here. And so I so appreciate everything that Chris is sharing with us and teaching us and just walking beside us in conversation on how to actually live that out in our real everyday lives where it really, really matters. Part two of my conversation with Chris begins with him sharing how the pandemic crisis became a ground of renewal for him and ultimately for his family, and how he believes the pandemic era that we're now entering is a time of great church renewal coming at the hands of a deep pruning. So I think you're going to be very inspired. Let's welcome Chris to the show.
Well, you know, Janelle, what you're saying really echoes with me. And one of the things that happened, one of the ways I'd say the pandemic crisis that I described has become a ground of renewal in my life is because for the first time in our church during the pandemic, when I was wrestling with all this, our church had a course called Emotionally Healthy Relationships. I've heard a lot about worship.
Yes.
How do we do good, strong worship? How do we do strong mission? Mm-hmm. How do we do
Children.
Strong social action? Mm-hmm. All these other areas. And I've been part of many churches over my decades of life, many churches. I had never been in a church that talked about this. So for me, it was like, I'm supposed to examine my emotions.
Oh, I'm sure.
Be mad. This was new ground for me. Like, so I'm just, you know, saying that after all that I experienced in Mississippi, at Duke, Africa, this is the first time where I was being introduced to a new terrain.
And it's a whole new terrain. Yes.
And it's been going back to where we started. It's been difficult and strange.
Yeah.
But it's been holy ground.
It is holy ground. Such a good word. And that book is by Peter Scazzaro, and it's so amazing. His work. Yes. So Pete,
we're in the church that Pete started.
No, you're not. Of course you are. You're in New York City.
That's our church, New Life Fellowship. So
dog. Yeah. Oh, that's amazing.
We didn't join the church knowing this. We were what are they talking about? Emotionally health? What is this?
Yeah, that was decades ago. That's what I found the table over now, because I feel like you are so blessed. I'm so happy you're there. You're going to be awesome. That's amazing. You're going to feel all your feels. Okay, take us to 7. Oh my goodness.
7 is, there's a lot in each of these chapters. There's a lot in each chapter, but I think there were 3 unprecedented dangers that were exposed by the pandemic. Okay. And I bring them together in the chapter, which is technological disruption.
Mm.
So if we think about like AI right now, AI has suddenly become... Everyone's talking about AI because of this. I forget the name of this new.
I don't know either.
AI thing. And so there's the power of data, the power of that we're seeing of internet addiction. Yeah. This is all the algorithms of division, all related to technological disruption. Secondly, ecological decay in our world, which harms God's creation. And thirdly, and I'm just going to throw this in because I do work at the United Nations, is the battle between the U.S. versus China.
Yeah.
And China's now, Americans name China as our number one enemy. But what I do in the book is bring these 3 existential dangers together and show how they affect affect all of our lives.
Okay.
And these are all border crossing problems.
Yeah.
And what we're called to practice is moral imagination in the midst of those challenges.
Okay. I want to dig into that for sure personally. And so 8.
Finally, renewing the church.
Mm.
Renewing the church for a world longing for hope. That the world is longing for hope. And the church, we're at a really difficult time.
We are.
I think a liminal time.
Yes.
The word that I use in the book, if I had to choose one word right now, we're in between, but the word I'm going to choose is pruning.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. Yes.
That God is pruning the church.
I agree.
And pruning, the reason I propose that word is because that means that the tree has been fruitful.
Yes. Don't prune if it's not fruitful.
Good news.
Mm-hmm.
The tree's been fruitful, but there comes a time when a tree begins to grow in a way that it's losing fruit, or the fruit is no longer tasty.
Right.
And then it requires pruning, cutting back. And pruning is very painful. And the tree looks ugly.
So like a crepe myrtle. There's just like, how can they ever grow again when they just chop it off?
Exactly. Donna's a gardener. I'm like, you're going to cut that?
Every year I go,
chop that.
Chop it off.
And so that's not violence. So we're not talking about violence.
No, we are not.
Image again, like a parable of Jesus, thinking, parabolically.
John 15. Yes.
Yes, exactly. John 15. Mm-hmm. But then in order to bear more fruit.
That's correct.
But we're in that time where to think back and remember, it's very important to remember that there's been times all throughout the history of the church since that's, the book of Acts and the birth of the church at Pentecost, where there have been times of pruning in times of crisis.
Extreme.
But these have become great times of, they've led to renewal movements.
Yes.
And I want to believe that that's what God is doing now. So we got to be patient with the pruning and be open then and be eager to see the renewal that God will bring.
Expectant. Exactly.
Expectant.
Yeah. It's like we know a crepe myrtle. I know in my head that a crepe myrtle looks like it's absolutely dead. And I have a lot of plants in my backyard that are succulents that just look completely and totally dead. And then they start coming up again. I'm like, what?
Yes.
You know, it's just green and they're just succulently, got liquid inside. And so, yes. So what I hear you saying as we close, because I can't believe I have to close, your epilogue is rest for restless hearts. Help us have, how do we do that? How do we have this rest? Because I do know so many people that are in such extreme despair and anxious. And, I just try to give hope, but How can we find this rest in our restless hearts while we're waiting? I'm particularly within the church. I'm trying to find out the answer to that myself.
Well, maybe I can speak about that as I'm a member of AA, but not Alcoholics Anonymous.
Okay.
Activists Anonymous.
Oh, wow. Okay. Didn't even know that existed.
No, it doesn't exist. It's my own club, and anyone else wants
like
to
I'm a, yes.
Me. But, and so I actually spent my 17 years in Mississippi. Toward the end of that time, a very close friend of mine died suddenly of a heart attack.
Oh.
And it was a before and after moment.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought I was going to and he and I worked together, and I thought, okay, I'm called to keep, now I got to keep this ministry moving
forward.
It's your
job.
Mm-hmm. I got to keep acting. See, that I wasn't restful. Mm-hmm. I was just overacting.
Yep.
Just, I have to. It's a
hyper.
The demand.
Right.
Mm-hmm. The demand. Trying harder, doing more. And I went away to a retreat center, and I realized for the first time, one of the central stories that my colleague and I taught was the Good Samaritan story in Luke 10. Go and do likewise, which is activism.
Mm-hmm.
But for the first time, I realized that that story is immediately followed in Luke's gospel. Jesus goes to Bethany. He goes to Bethany, and there's Mary, still at his feet while Martha is busy.
So true.
And that we're called to extravagant action.
Yeah.
That must be grounded in extravagant devotion.
Oh, it's so good.
And I didn't realize, Janelle, until I was at that retreat, this is the first retreat I'd taken in 17 years of ministry.
Oh, no. Well, okay. How long ago was that? A long time ago?
That was 25 years ago.
Right. That was what we didn't know. I mean, self-care, you didn't do that.
Yeah.
You did not do it.
I practice that every
good
year. So that's
good.
What I call the book a not-to rhythm.
Yeah.
We have all kinds of have-to. So my answer to your question is rest is found. One of the ways we learn rest is by practicing not-to rhythms, Sabbath keeping, being still. Being playing on the Sabbath, retreat, these not two rhythms.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I want to say is we learn rest by actually practicing, creating space to slow down, be still. I know that's hard for all of us. It's very difficult, but that's the point. We've got to. That's how I want to answer is that. And that is, I think it's in that space. Augustine said, our hearts are restless until they find their rest in thee. And it's in that belovedness, those spaces of being still and allowing ourselves to receive God's belovedness.
Mm-hmm.
That's where we'll find the space for rest to then live in this challenging time.
And I just saw like a vision, like I'm not kidding. This is so Gracie, but that pruned crepe myrtle, right? We just saw it. It's just bare skin, bare barked, and they just cut it off. But when you were speaking, you took me back to practice one, to bearing joy.
Yes.
There it is. And if we can get this, if we can get what you just said, if we can get these not so rhythms, right? That's what you said.
Not to do.
Right.
Rhythms. So much determine our lives.
So much to do.
Mine too. But how do we then create the space for not to? Yes. And that then is about how we get the love of God into our bones.
It's extravagant love in devotion before extravagant movements of God.
Absolutely. As a mentor said to me once, the Bible talks a lot about loving God, talks a lot about loving neighbor, but it talks a lot more about God's love for us.
Oh my goodness.
Here before Jesus began his ministry in Luke 4 is Luke 2. This is my beloved son with whom I'm well pleased. Before Jesus has done anything.
Yes.
He's beloved. It's the same for us.
It is.
But we got to put ourselves in the places where we can get that love of God into our bones. Also, we need people.
We do. We have, you we have will, to have community.
We'll put that love into our bones.
Real love, the nitty gritty.
Absolutely.
Sitting at a table, getting it all out so that we can have velveteen rabbit real love. Exactly.
Amen.
Oh my goodness, Chris. I do not want to stop. This is so powerful. But I do know, I just feel like once we get that, once we as individuals really understand how to be that Mary, right? That devotion. I think the tree, it's going to start producing fruit like crazy. And we will have that rooted. Now we'll be rooted then in that love of God. That's what he tells us to be rooted and grounded, right? In the depths of God's love. That's it.
That is.
Thank you so much.
Thanks so much for this conversation.
I'm so rich. You're just helping us grow in such a beautiful way. Tell us where we can find you so everybody can order your book and find you, Chris. Where's the easiest, best place?
I have a website, chrisriceauthor.com. Mm-hmm. chrisriceauthor.com. You can find my book, Pandemic to Renewal, at Amazon, at InterVarsity Press as the publisher.
Yes.
And you're, I'm sure your favorite online book source or your independent local
support
bookstore,
those independents.
They can order it for you.
Yeah.
So,
or the library, but then
it's there.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I will love to have you back in the future to talk more, because this was stimulating conversation. And my hero, Ann Morrow Lindberg, says, you know, stimulating conversation is far better than coffee.
Amen.
Amen.
For me too, Janelle. I'm really grateful for this back and forth.
Thank you.
And for your ministry through this podcast.
Thank you so much.
Heartlifters, wow. I took so many notes during this editing process that my page is bursting. One of the things that I wanted to leave us with in our podcast prompt today is to think about Chris's words. We are called to extravagant action, but that must be grounded in extravagant devotion. Oh, I'm going to say that again. We are called to extravagant action, but that must be grounded in extravagant devotion. What does that speak to your heart? He says, rest is learned in the not to rhythms. You know, we're so used to the to-do list, but what about a not to-do list? And that is going to involve our practices of contemplation, stillness, silence, solitude, being still before God, just knowing he's God, worship like Mary at Jesus' feet. Yes, we are called to be those Marthas too, right? Extravagant action. But that must be grounded in, as Jesus said, that more desirable, that more profitable gift of extravagant worship. That was a call to my heart. And I really want to hear what it speaks to your heart. I'll leave you with his words. We have to get the love of God into our bones. Oh my gosh. We have to get the love of God into our bones. Please meet me over on Instagram at Janelle Reardon. Wherever I post this is where I'm going to be talking about it. And I just really want to engage with you. What is your heart hearing? What is your heart saying to you? Until next time.
Thanks for listening today. It was great having you here. For even more great content and resources, please join the Stronger Everyday online community at JanelleRiordan.com. Always remember, you, my friend, have value, worth, and dignity.